Perhaps the most extraordinary thing about Shahid Qasim Soleimani is how truly ordinary he was. He was born on March the 11th, 1957, in the Kerman province of Iran, in the unexceptional village of Qanat-e-Malik. Like others, he went to school, had a regular upbringing, and later found work in construction to help repay the agricultural debts accumulated by his father. At the age of 18, he began working for the Kerman Water Organization. This youth, just like many others, would visit family and friends, had a healthy social life, and would go to the gym to work out. It was at this ripe age of his that he would give ear to the public sermons of a humble scholar, through whom Qasim Soleimani was inspired to take up revolutionary endeavors. In 1979, the Islamic Revolution took place. The Western-backed dictator, the Shah, fled. The faqih, Islamic jurist, had been given control over the affairs of the state, and the nation rejoiced at its newfound liberation. This would herald a bright new era, paving the way for the return of Imam Mahdi, ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif. While the nation celebrated, Qasim Soleimani knew that the toughest battles were yet to begin. America, the Soviet Union, and their cohorts throughout the world would not readily tolerate a free Islamic nation whose leader was not under their control. They had already begun devising plans to quash the revolution. And so, he joined the Revolutionary Guard, the IRGC. With little training, he quickly advanced in his military proficiency, initially a mere guardsman stationed in northwestern Iran. The enemies were on the move. The Islamic Revolution would not be tolerated by the world powers. They needed an instrument of war to lay siege upon the newly formed Islamic Republic of Iran. Saddam Hussein, the tyrannical dictator positioned in the neighboring country of Iraq, became the best candidate. Backed by America, the Soviet Union, Britain, France, and Germany, to name a few, Saddam Hussein became their fully fledged agent of war. At this time, Iran had little hope. Years of oppression under the rule of the Shah had left the nation almost entirely dependent on the world powers. They could not even make their own barbed wire, let alone the kinds of ammunition, missiles, fighter jets, tanks, and other military equipment necessary to fight back against the world that now stood against it. On the 22nd of September 1980, Saddam Hussein launched a full-scale invasion of Iran. Using Soviet MiG-23BNs, Tu-22 and Su-20 fighter aircrafts, the Iraqi Air Force launched surprise airstrikes on 10 Iranian airfields to obliterate the Iranian Air Force. The following day, Saddam launched a ground invasion in 3 simultaneous attacks, wanting to break the back of the Islamic Revolution. Of the 6 divisions that invaded by ground, 2 crossed over the northern and central borders to attack the heart of Iran. The other 4 were sent to Khuzestan in the south. The objective? Control Abadan and Khorramshahr, 2 strategic port cities. Saddam had hoped that the ethnic Arabs of Khuzestan would abandon the Islamic Revolution, but the people of the region remained loyal to Iran. And in fact, even the Iraqi troops themselves have been described as badly led and lacking in offensive spirit. Inside their hearts, Saddam's troops knew that the cause they were fighting for could not be justified. Still, they followed the orders of the tyrannical powers. In Khorramshahr, heavy losses left 7,000 dead on both sides. The city became known as the City of Blood. Ruthlessly, Saddam Hussein used chemical weapons supplied by the West to devastate the people of Iran. Saddam took control of Mehran. Furthermore, Saddam's forces advanced into the Zagros Mountains and took control of this strategic invasion point. But the leader and the people of Iran would not give up. With AH-1 Cobra helicopter gunships and F-4 Phantoms, armed with Maverick missiles, they began fierce attacks on the advancing Iraqi divisions, destroyed their armored vehicles, and slowed Saddam's advance. Firing Phoenix missiles, they shot down dozens of Iraq's Soviet-built fighters. The newly formed Revolutionary Iranian Air Force also retaliated with conviction and precision, with a large-scale attack against Iraqi air bases and infrastructure in Operation Command 99. Using the salvaged F-4 Phantom and F-5 Tiger fighter jets, they attacked oil facilities, petrochemical plants, oil refineries, and the Mosul air base. Saddam was taken by surprise by this firm response, and economic disruption was caused within Iraq. But Iranians were taking heavy losses, and while Saddam's depleted forces were being buffed up by the world superpowers, Iran had been put under sanctions and had only its faith in its own people and in Allah. In 1981, Imam Khamenei was elected president of Iran by a landslide vote of 97%. His sound resolve, knowledge, zeal, and bravery would further strengthen the leadership. The Iranian military, police forces, and the Revolutionary Guards all acted with the same goals in mind: resist the tyranny of the invaders and defend the Islamic Revolution. But they were not alone. Many, many voluntary fighters from among the common people, known as the Basij, each entered the fray separately in a bid to protect their nation and the noble cause of the Islamic Revolution. Qasem Soleimani quickly excelled in ranks, mustering his experiences to become a leader. In Kerman, he assembled a host of valiant warriors whom he trained and, with the spirit of resistance and faith, fought back against the assailants. Showing absolute and unparalleled resolve, fortitude, and faith, the people of Iran would fight in the deserts, they would fight in the marshes and the mountains, they would fight until their last breaths. The war would last 8 long years and would go on to be known as the Sacred Defense. Qasem Soleimani soon became renowned for his bravery, aptitude, and strength for his key role in operations to reclaim the land Saddam Hussein had occupied. While still in his 20s, he became the commander of the 41st Darullah Division and was at the forefront of major operations in the south. Bostan had been taken by the enemy, and an important supply route was under their control. Thus, on the 29th of November 1981, Operation Tariq al-Quds was launched. The Iranians would march at the enemy, wave after wave. They took serious losses. 6,000 Iranians were killed in the fighting, and Qasem Soleimani was seriously injured. But through his leadership and the prowess of his comrades, Bostan was liberated and the key supply route for Saddam's forces eliminated. On the 22nd of March 1982, Lieutenant General Sayyad Shirazi would lead the operation Fathul Mubin, the manifest victory. This would be a huge turning point in the war, so it is no wonder that Qasem Soleimani was present in this key battle for the liberation of Khorramshahr. With a constant push of faith and resilience, the Iranians hit the enemy's wave upon wave upon wave of fighters. They took many losses and gave many martyrs. Saddam's forces enjoyed the use of tanks, artillery, and aerial support, while the Pasdaran and Basijis of Iran were mostly fighting on foot. They saw their comrades falling. They saw the enemies having far more strength and witnessed the power of America and the Soviet Union's support. They were outmatched and the odds were stacked against them with no end in sight. Still, they kept on fighting. Qasem Soleimani kept on fighting. On the 28th, the Iraqis had taken heavy losses. The Iranians showed no signs of backing down, so Saddam called for a retreat. Eventually, the revolutionaries were able to liberate Khorramshahr and push the Iraqi forces from southern Iran. From this moment onwards, Iran would no longer be on the defensive, but would bring the fight to Saddam's backyard. Despite being outnumbered, despite the world superpowers standing against them, the Iranians overcame with pure patience and faith. The Holy Quran says, "Those who were sure that they would meet their Lord said, 'How often has a small party vanquished a numerous host? by Allah's permission, and Allah is with the patient. The war ended on the 20th of August 1988. Iran liberated itself completely and proved that it was a force to be reckoned with. Due to how difficult this struggle had been and how rewarding the divine struggle was, Qasim Soleimani referred to Operation Fathul Mubin, the Manifest Victory, as the best and most memorable chapter of the Sacred Defense War. Qasim Soleimani was only 31 years old, but he had already shown his quality, stature, courage, and faith. He had not been slain like so many of his comrades. Allah was saving him for something more. The Holy Quran states,
قَالَ الَّذِينَ يَظُنُّونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا اللَّهِ كَمْ